Harriet Tubman, The Moses of Her People, by Sarah H. Bradford. Copyright 1886. This recording copyright 2018 by Jim Hodges of jimhodgesaudiobooks.com. Farewell, old marster. Don't think hard of me. I'm going on to Canada, where all de slaves are free. Jesus, Jesus, will go with you. He will lead you to his throne. He who died has gone before you, trod the winepress all alone. On a hot summer's day, perhaps 60 years ago, a group of merry little darkies were rolling and tumbling in the sand in front of the large house of a southern planter. Their shining skins gleamed in the sun as they rolled over each other in their play, and their voices, as they chattered together or shouted in glee, reached even to the cabins of the Negro quarter, where the old people groaned in spirit as they thought of the future of those unconscious young revelers, and their cry went up, "O Lord, how long?" Apart from the rest of the children, on the top rail of a fence, holding tight onto the tall gatepost, sat a little girl of perhaps 13 years of age, darker than any of the others, and with a more decided wooliness in her hair, a pure, unmitigated African. She was not so entirely in a state of nature as the rollers in the dust beneath her, but her only garment was a short woolen skirt, which was tied around her waist and reached about to her knees. She seemed a dazed and stupid child, and as her head hung upon her breast, she looked up with dull, bloodshot eyes towards her young brothers and sisters, without seeming to see them. By and by the eyes closed, and still clinging to the post, she slept. The other children looked up and said to each other, "Look at that! She's done gone off again!" Tired of their present playground, they trooped off in another direction, but the girl slept on heavily, never losing her hold on the post or her seat on her perch. Behold here, in the stupid little Negro girl, the future deliverer of hundreds of her people, the spy and scout of the Union armies, the devoted hospital nurse, the protector of hunted fugitives, the eloquent speaker in public meetings, the cunning eluder of pursuing manhunters, the heaven-guided pioneer through dangers seen and unseen, in short, as she has well been called, the Moses of her people. Here in her 13th year, she is just recovering from the first terrible effects of an injury inflicted by her master, who, in an ungovernable fit of rage, threw a heavy weight at the unoffending child, breaking in her skull and causing a pressure upon her brain, from which in her old age she is suffering still. This pressure it was which caused the fits of somnolency so frequently to come upon her, and which gave her the appearance of being stupid and half-witted in those early years. But that brain, which seemed so dull, was full of busy thoughts, and her life problem was already trying to work itself out there. She had heard the shrieks and cries of women who were being flogged in the Negro quarter. She had listened to the groaned-out prayer, "O Lord, have mercy!" She had already seen two older sisters taken away as part of a chain gang, and they had gone no one knew whither. She had seen the agonized expression on their faces as they turned to take a last look at their old cabin home, and had watched them from the top of the fence as they went off weeping and lamenting till they were hidden from her sight forever. She saw the hopeless grief of the poor old mother and the silent despair of the aged father, and already she began to revolve in her mind the question, "Why should such things be? Is there no deliverance for my people?" The sun shone on, and Harriet still slept seated on the fence rail. They, those others, had no anxious dreams of the future, and even the occasional sufferings of the present time caused them but a temporary grief. Plenty to eat and warm sunshine to bask in were enough to constitute their happiness. Harriet, however, was not one of these. God had a great work for her to do in the world, and the discipline and hardship through which she passed in her early years were only preparing her for her afterlife of adventure and trial, and through these to come out as the savior and deliverer of her people when she came to years of womanhood. As yet, she had seen no visions and heard no voices, no foreshadowing of her life of toil and privation, of flight before human bloodhounds, of watchings and hidings, of perils by land and perils by sea, yea, and of perils by false brethren.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.